Okay, so yesterday we had started with antipsychotic drugs. We have seen the definition, classification, and we had started with the chlorpromazine. As a prototype drug, we have seen the actions, pharmacokinetics, tolerance and all. Okay, so before moving to the other parts like interactions and the adverse effects and uses, we'll see what are the distinctive features of the other neuroleptics. Okay, so we have seen chlorpromazine in details. Now, all the antipsychotics more or less, okay, mostly the typical antipsychotics as we call the others, okay, excepting the atypical antipsychotics, they are all called as typical antipsychotics. Okay, so they mostly differ in their potency and their propensity to produce different actions. Okay, so under the actions, whatever we have seen that there are many disadvantages also under the actions. We have seen endocrine changes take place. Okay, so those tendencies to produce the actions are little bit different with different kinds of agents. Okay, so now to continue with that first class, okay, chlorpromazine belongs to the first class, that is phenothiazine. Okay, so under phenothiazine also there are three subclassifications depending upon the side chain which is attached. Okay, so aliphatic side chain phenothiazines are chlorpromazine and trifluropromazine. So this is the second example belonging to the subclass aliphatic side chain of the phenothiazine class. Okay, so this, if you can consider, the properties are similar, but it is more potent as compared to your CPZ. CPZ is chlorpromazine. Okay, so this drug is little bit more potent. So less amount of this drug is required as compared to CPZ to produce the same amount of action. Mainly this drug is used as anti-emetic, because we have seen that antipsychotics also possess anti-emetic action because of blockage of D2 receptors in the CTZ. Okay. The disadvantage of this drug is that it produces the acute muscle dystonias, especially in the children. Okay, muscle dystonias meaning this is involuntary contraction of your skeletal muscles in certain areas. Now, skeletal muscles, they contract only as per your wish, right? They are voluntary in nature. But what happens over here is there are certain motor side effects which are precipitated by these antipsychotic drugs. Okay, so that is a major drawback with extrapyramidal side effects, they are collectively known as. Okay, so muscle dystonias are precipitated specifically in children and especially when they are injected. Okay, so as far as possible, avoid injection of these drugs in small children. Otherwise, muscle dystonias may be precipitated. The next drug is thioridazine. This belongs to piperidine side chain derivative of the phenothiazine. So this is comparatively having a low potency. Okay, that means a little bit higher dose will be required to produce the antipsychotic action. And it also has, mainly it acts through the dopaminergic receptors, as we have seen. But these also have marked central anticholinergic action also. Okay, we have seen under the actions on ANS that antipsychotics also have anti-adrenergic property, anticholinergic property. So thioridazine, this is having marked central anticholinergic action also in addition. Okay, now comparatively the incidence of extrapyramidal side effects is very low as compared to the other phenothiazines with this. Okay, but more commonly arrhythmias may be precipitated. Okay, side effects like arrhythmias or interference with the male sexual functions. Okay, so these are the main limitations, so main or most commonly occurring side effects, and this limits the use. It is damaging to your eyes. Okay, so upon long term use, it can damage the eyes. So this is the adverse effects which actually limits the use of this, or the clinical utilization of this thioridazine in the psychotic patients also. Then coming to another two drugs which are actually again belonging to the subclass of phenothiazines itself, that is piperazine side chain derivatives, these are. Okay, both of these. There are only two examples under this piperazine side chain phenothiazines, that is trifluperazine and flufenazine. So these are again high potency drug. Okay, so it, as we have seen that they may vary in potency or propensity to produce certain side effects or actions. Okay, so here again these two are high potency piperazine side chain phenothiazines. Okay, and they have minimum autonomic action. That means they have little action on your autonomic nervous system as compared to the other examples. Okay, so because of its minimum action on this autonomic system, the tendency to produce certain side effects, okay, like hypotension, maybe sedation, or lowering of the seizure thresholds. So these are not significant. Okay, they are also less likely to impair the glucose tolerance, jaundice, precipitating tendency, or hypersensitivity. Reactions are also low with these particular drug. Okay, however, the extrapyramidal side effects, these are quite marked with these drugs. Okay, so they are more selective towards blocking the D2 receptors. So that's why there are more chances of precipitation of extrapyramidal side effects. And one of this drug, that is flupenazine, the deconate form, it can also be used as a depot preparation. Okay, that is controlled release preparation is possible. So the release will be prolonged, so it will become a long acting. That's the meaning of depot preparation. Okay, so in the form of IM injection, every 2 to 4 weeks it can be given. So it has a quite a long action. So you need not give this drug very frequently. You need to give it every 2 to 4 weeks, once a day. The next is your second class. These drugs belong to the second class, that is butyrophenols. Okay, there are three examples over there. So first one is haloperidol. So this is again a potent antipsychotic agent. Okay, but here the pharmacological profile, it is resembling to that of piperazine substituted phenothiazine. Okay, though it is classified separately, the pharmacological profile is similar to these agents belonging to piperazine side chain, that is trifluoperazine and flupenazine. Now, are the examples belonging to these class. Okay, so haloperidol has similar properties. It produces few autonomic effects. It is less epileptogenic, that is less tendency to precipitate the epileptic attacks or seizures. Seizure threshold lowering tendency is low with this drug. It does not cause any weight gain, okay, no metabolic changes. Jaundice also occur very, very rarely. Okay, so the conditions for which this drug is preferred, okay, for what it is used is acute schizophrenia, short-lasting schizophrenia, Huntington's disease. In this disease, there is damage to the brain cells. Okay, your brain neurons gets damaged in these this particular condition. Then one more condition known as Gilles-de-la-Tourette syndrome. Here again, this is again a neurological disorder wherein there is involuntary movements which take place. Okay, actually the person is not making those movements or those sounds purposefully. Okay, like say for example blinking of the eyes, okay, or blinking of your eyelids. Okay, some people have the tendency to constantly blink the eyelids, okay, or just pull up the shoulders. Okay, actually these are not voluntary, these are involuntary in nature. That's because of the neurological disorder. So some kind of specific sound the person may make, or specific body movements may be seen constantly. So that's what is happening over here. Because of the neurological disorders, those involuntary sounds or movements are being produced. Then the metabolism part, okay, that is kinetics. It is metabolized by these two enzymes, CYP3A4 and 2D6. Quite important enzymes, okay, for the phase 1 reactions, oxidation reactions. Okay, then elimination T half-life is 24 hours. So it's a quite a long acting drug. Okay, the next drug involved under the butyrophenols is trifluoperidol. This again has similar properties to haloperidol, but it is more potent as compared to haloperidol. So less amount of drug is required over here. And one more example under butyrophenols is penfluridol. Okay, now this particular drug is an exceptionally long acting neuroleptic. So its T half-life is very, very long, so it is preferred in conditions like chronic schizophrenia, those who suffer from chronic schizophrenia, who need a long-term treatment. So this drug being a long-acting one, you can use less number of doses in these individuals and avoid the significant adverse effects also. It is also preferred in affective withdrawals or social maladjustment like conditions, neurological conditions also. And the next class is thiazolidates. Okay, only example under this is fluphenthiazole. So now this, as compared to CPZ, this is less sedative. Less drowsiness is produced by this particular agent. And again, it is indicated in schizophrenia, psychosis-like condition, or withdrawn or apathetic condition of the patient. Apathetic condition meaning the person's lack of social involvement or initiators. The person will remain withdrawn and all. So such kind of conditions, if it is seen in the patient, it can be treated with the fluphenthiazole. But it should be avoided in conditions where there is psychomotor agitation, or if your psychomotor functions are getting affected, severely affected, or in case of mania, if the person is suffering from mania, then it should be avoided. Okay. Rather, this drug is not quite very popular. Then the next class, that is other heterocyclics. There are two examples under this, pimozid and loxapine. Okay, coming to the pimozid, this is again a specific dopamine antagonist with little alpha adrenergic or cholinergic blocking activity. Okay, so it is more specific towards blocking the dopamine receptor. Okay, so there are less chances of other side effects being precipitated over here. Okay, then again, if you consider the duration of action is quite long. It may act for several days. Okay, and if you can see the elimination T half-life, it is 48 to 60 hours. So it's quite a long acting agent, so it is preferred for maintenance therapy. Okay, in chronically ill patient, as a maintenance therapy, this drug may be continued. However, it should be avoided in psychomotor agitation. If the patient is suffering from any kind of psychomotor agitation, it should be avoided. Then if you can see the adverse effect tendency, the incidences of dystonic reaction, that is muscle dystonia, it is low with this pimozid, but myocardial APD, that is action potential duration, a duration for which one action potential lasts, so that is prolonged. Okay, so there will be less number of action potentials. So normally whatever duration one action potential takes place, that duration is prolonged. So there are chances of arrhythmias, slowing of the conduction or slowing of generation or of your action potential is also a type of arrhythmias. Arrhythmia doesn't mean that only there is tachycardias. Slowing of conduction or slowing of AP generation is also a type of arrhythmia. So normal rhythm is affected. So there are chances of arrhythmia precipitation with pimozid. Then apart from being used as an antipsychotic, it is also used in this condition. Gilles de la Tourette syndrome and tics, facial tics also occur in this condition also. Wherein small muscles in your face region or cheek region, okay, so they try to, you know, contract and relax. Okay, so those are known as facial tics. Okay, the next drug under this same class, that is other heterocyclic class, loxapine. This is actually a dibenzoxapine. Action is similar to that of CPZ. Dopamine receptor blocking tendencies will have antipsychotic action. But the duration of action and its onset of action is quick, but duration of action is short. Okay, and the T half-life also you can see that it is only 8 hours. So it's a short acting drug, so more number of doses may be required. As such, there are no clear-cut advantages over other antipsychotics. Okay, so it is not again quite a popular drug. Then coming to the last class, that is atypical antipsychotics, or they are also known as second generation antipsychotics. Okay, because this is a recently introduced class. Okay, that's why it is known as a second generation antipsychotics, and the properties are also quite different from that of the other or the typical antipsychotics. Whatever we have seen so far are commonly known as a typical antipsychotics. Okay, and the major limitation with these typical antipsychotics is they tend to produce a large number of adverse effects, out of which the major limitation is the extrapyramidal side effects. typical antipsychotics are classified separately because altogether they act by different mechanism. Now, so far we have seen all the drugs mainly act through blockage of the D2 receptors. And that D2 receptor blockage in the basal ganglia is actually responsible for the extrapyramidal side effects, which is a major limitation. No doubt they are effective as antipsychotics. It's not that they are not effective, but they cause many endocrine changes, many autonomic changes, then many psychomotor changes are also produced. So that limits the use of typical antipsychotics, and search has been continued for a better class of drug. So this newer agents which are discovered nowadays, these are classified as atypical antipsychotics because they have less tendency to block the D2 receptor. So far we have seen that under chlorpromazine also we have seen that the major mechanism is blockage of the D2 receptors. But these newer agents, they have weak D2 blocking property. Their D2 blocking property is weak, but they have more potent 5-HT receptor blocking property. 5-HT2 subtype of receptor mainly is blocked. Of course, there are certain drugs which can block the other types of receptors also, but these are mainly responsible. Blockage of the serotonergic receptor, 5-HT is serotonin. So, blockage of the or antagonistic action at the 5-HT2 receptor mainly is responsible for the antipsychotic action. Okay, so dopamine therapy, the dopamine theory of antipsychotic action doesn't hold true over here, because it's not only the D2 blocking action, rather it's having weak D2 blocking action, but still they are quite good antipsychotic agent. And since they have weak D2 blocking tendency, extrapyramidal side effects are minimum with these agents. Even the endocrine changes which are taking place, so those are also minimum. Only few agents show those endocrine changes, mainly the hormonal changes which are seen. So these are less likely with the atypical antipsychotics. Okay. So coming to the individual agents under this, the first agent which was discovered under this class was clozapine. So as we have already seen, it has only weak D2 blocking action. So it produces few or no extrapyramidal symptoms, tardive dyskinesia. This is a common side effect or adverse effect, extrapyramidal side effect. So this is also rare. Prolactin levels, we have seen that hyperprolactinemia is precipitated because of the D2 blocking action. As dopamine has inhibitory action on the prolactin release, so because of dopamine blockage or D2 blockage, prolactin levels may increase. So there are changes, some kind of reproductive changes which are taking place in the reproductive systems of the males as well as in the females. Galactorrhea, gynecomastia, and all that changes has taken place. Menstrual cycle also changes. Okay, so those changes we are seeing. So these clozapine being a weak D2 blocking agent, there are less chances for it to raise the prolactin levels. Okay, or rather prolactin levels do not rise under the influence of clozapine. Okay, so it has a therapeutic benefit in this schizophrenia. Both positive and negative symptoms are controlled. What are positive and negative symptoms? Positive symptoms meaning symptoms like visual symptoms, hallucinations, like seeing something which is not existing, auditory, hearing something which is not existing, false delusions. Okay, so these are categorized as positive symptoms. And negative symptoms meaning the behavioral changes, like say for example the person do not take initiative. Okay, so person tries to remain less social, don't mingle with people. Okay, so such kind of symptoms are known as negative symptoms. So both positive as well as negative symptoms of schizophrenia can be effectively controlled, and even those patients who are refractory to the typical neuroleptics or the typical antipsychotics which we have discussed so far. So if any person is refractory, meaning not responding to these typical antipsychotics, will respond to clozapine. So it is actually a reserve drug, an alternative drug to the typical antipsychotics. So those patients who are not benefiting by these typical neuroleptics can be switched over to this clozapine or atypical antipsychotics, they will start responding. Okay, and the differing pharmacological profile, we have seen that it's because of their differential actions on the receptor. It's not mainly blocking the D2 receptor, it's only weakly blocking this D2 receptor. It also has affinity for D4 receptor of dopamine, and it has 5H2 blockage mainly. Okay, and also alpha blockage, alpha adrenergic blockage. So these differential actions is because of its differential action on the various receptors. It is not mainly affecting the D2 receptor. That's how it is showing a differential pharmacological profile as compared to typical antipsychotics. Then certain adverse effects like sedation may be seen with these drugs. These are moderately potent anticholinergics. Okay, anticholinergic action is also seen, so anticholinergic side effects may also be precipitated. Okay, hypersalivation may be precipitated. Then apart from blocking these receptors, it also can block the H1 histaminic receptor also. This could be responsible for the sedative property addition. Okay, H1 subtype of the histamine receptor is also blocked by this agent. And the kinetics, it is metabolized by these three enzymes, CYP1A2, 2C19 and 3A4 are the three enzymes involved in metabolism. Certain metabolites may be active, certain metabolites generated may be inactive, and the average T half-life of all considering together is 12 hours. Okay, so not quite a long acting agent. Okay, so 12 hours is the T half-life, average T half-life. Okay, some have shorter T half-life, some of the drugs or some of the metabolites have longer T half-life. Okay, now one more major drawback with this agent is it can precipitate agranulocytosis, that is decrease in the agranulocyte levels in your blood. Okay, or some other blood dyskrasias. Blood dyskrasias meaning changes in the levels of the blood cells. Okay, so it may change the number of cells, blood cells. Okay, so major ones which are getting affected is the WBCs. Okay, so WBC count may be lowered. Okay, agranulocytosis is a condition wherein it may go low. Okay, so you may need to monitor the leukocyte count. Weekly monitoring of leukocyte count is required when this particular drug is administered. Then, if high doses are administered in higher doses, it can even induce seizures in non-epileptics. Those patients who are not suffering from epilepsy, in such individuals also seizures may be precipitated. Okay. Apart from that, other side effects, as we have already seen, sedation is produced, unstable BP, BP may be fluctuating due to its effects on the other receptors. Okay. Then urinary incontinence, that is control over the bladder, may be lost. Okay. Then tachycardia, increase in the heart rate. Then weight gain, metabolic changes, okay, weight gain may be seen. Hyperlipidemia, that is increase in the lipids in your blood, and even precipitation of diabetes may be seen. Sometimes even myocarditis may be also precipitated, that is inflammation of the your cardiac wall, okay, cardiac muscles may be seen. And slowly it may even progress to death. Okay, so this is quite dangerous. Okay, so as such, this is a reserved drug in resistant cases of schizophrenia. Those which are not responding to other drugs, you can switch over to clozapine. Otherwise, it is not frequently used because of these adverse effects which can be precipitated. And the next drug is risperidone. This is again having D2 receptor blockage, weak D2 receptor blockage, as well as 5H2 receptor blocking property. Apart from that, risperidone can also block the other receptors also. Alpha-1, alpha-2 and H1 antihistaminic receptors can also be blocked. So blockage of these other receptors can add to its efficacy also, and plus, that is its therapeutic effect, and plus it can also add to the side effects also, like postural hypotension may be precipitated. Okay. So other receptors, if they are blocked, okay, they may contribute to the adverse effects also. Here, postural hypotension is precipitated. But if this risperidone is combined with selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, these are the drugs which are acting as antidepressant, SSRIs. Okay, so this is a class belonging to antidepressant drugs. So if risperidone is combined with any of the drugs belonging to this class, rise in BP can be precipitated. BP will increase, hypertension can be precipitated. Now if we can compare this risperidone with clozapine, it has more potent action on the D2 receptor. More potent D2 blocking tendency is there as compared to clozapine. Okay. So extrapyramidal side effects tendency is more obviously as compared to the clozapine. Okay, so risperidone has to be given in very low doses, then and only then the extrapyramidal side effects will not be seen. Okay, so the levels as low as less than 6 milligrams per day, okay, are required for it not to precipitate the extrapyramidal side effects. Okay, also it has potent D2 blocking tendency, so that's why prolactin levels may rise disproportionately, so that's a drawback. But it is less epileptogenic, it cannot precipitate the epilepsies as much as clozapine can do. We have seen that it has seizure precipitating tendency even in non-epileptics, but that tendency is not seen with risperidone. Okay, but agitation, mental agitation may be caused by this particular agent. Apart from that, weight gain tendency or incidences of new onset diabetes, worsening of diabetes or precipitation of diabetes in a non-diabetic patient, these are less as compared to clozapine. Okay. But this again is a problem. Risk of stroke. Stroke may be precipitated in the elderly. Stroke is a condition wherein there is a lack of blood supply to your brain. Okay, so several actions or several physiological changes might take place. It is quite dangerous if the person suffers from stroke. Okay, so elderly are more at risk of precipitation of stroke. So as far as possible, avoid this drug in elderly patients. Okay, the next drug is olanzapine. This is again resembles the clozapine in blocking the multiple receptors. There is many types of receptors are blocked, V2, 5-HT2. Okay, then alpha 1 alpha 2, muscarinic receptors and H1 antisense. So many types of receptors may be blocked by this particular agent. Okay, very effective in schizophrenia, positive and negative both kind of symptoms may be controlled. So also its spectrum of action is broad. That is, it is not only effective in the schizophrenia or psychological conditions or psychotic conditions, but it is also useful in mania. We have seen under the anti-manic drugs. Okay, so it is also effectively used in mania as an alternative to lithium, we have seen. Okay, so olanzapine, it is a potent anti-muscarinic also, as we have seen, it can block the muscarinic receptor. It is a potent anti-muscarinic, so it can precipitate the anticholinergic side effects like dryness of mouth or constipation may be precipitated. Then D2 blocking tendency with this drug is less, okay, as compared to other drugs. So there are less of precipitation of extrapyramidal side effects. These are mainly because of D2 blockage. So there are less extrapyramidal side effects. Little rise in prolactin levels will be seen, but it is more epileptogenic, okay, as compared to other phenothiazines, typical antipsychotics. There are more chances of precipitation of epilepsies. Then weight gain tendencies, then even worsening of the diabetes or elevation of triglycerides, these are also more, there are more chances of precipitating such conditions. Stroke precipitation tendency in elderly is also more likely. Whereas if you can consider agranulocytosis, okay, that is not reported with olanzapine. It does not alter the levels of the WBC. Then metabolism, it takes place with the enzyme CYP1A2 and glucuronyl transferase. These are the two enzymes responsible for the metabolism, and the T half life is 24 to 30 hours. So it is again a long acting agent. Next drug is quetiapine. This is a short acting agent. You can see the T half life is just 6 hours. So kinetics are quite variable within this class also. Okay, so because of the short T half life, twice daily dosing is required. Okay, single dose is not sufficient over here. Then if you can see the receptors, types of receptors which it can block is 5-HT1A, 5-HT2, D2 receptors, then alpha-1, alpha-2, and even histamic H1 receptors can also be blocked. But if you can consider all these, D2 blocking activity is low. Okay, less potent in blocking the D2 receptors, so extrapyramidal side effects or tendency to produce the hyperprolactinemia are minimum with this particular drug, quetiapine. But sedation is more prominent. H1 receptor blockage is seen, so sedation producing tendency is more. Okay, so sedation is the most common side effect. Okay, and also postural hypotension can also be seen. Then in certain individuals, urinary retention or urinary incontinence, loss of control of the bladder. Okay, or maybe urinary retention, both are possible in certain individuals. Okay, then weight gain, rise in blood glucose level, that is diabetes precipitation tendency, these are moderate. Okay, but QT prolongation can take place, that is arrhythmia precipitation tendency is there with this particular agent. And if you can see that this drug can also be given in mania or bipolar disorder also, along with acting as antipsychotic. It is also effective in the affective disorders like mania or even bipolar disorder also. Manic, depressive, cyclic mood changes also can be treated. Then metabolism part, it is metabolized by CYP3A4. So there are chances of interactions, that is drugs which can either induce or inhibit this enzyme, drugs like macrolides, antifungals or anticonvulsants. So interactions are possible with these agents. And aripiprazole, this is again a unique agent because here there is a partial agonistic property at D2 receptor and 5-HT1A receptor. So far we have seen that all the drugs block the D2 receptor, but these have partial agonistic property. These are not full agonist but partial agonist. And it has the antagonistic property also at 5-HT2 subtype of receptor. So because of this differential action, it is non-sedating, sometimes even may result in insomnia, that is lack of sleep, extrapyramidal side effects or hyperprolactinemia, hypertension, these are not significant, little tendency to produce weight gain, metabolic changes like weight gain or blood sugar rising tendency is also low, but prolongation of QT interval will take place at high doses, so the arrhythmias may be precipitated. Then frequent side effects, so more tendency to produce nausea, dyspepsia, that is indigestion, constipation and lightheadedness. Then aripiprazole kinetics, if you can consider it, is quite long acting drug, that is C-half-life is around about 3 days, so it's a very long acting drug, so that dose adjustment may be required after 2 to 3 weeks of the treatment. Metabolism takes place with CYP3A4 and 2D6. So when it is combined with ketoconazole or quinidine, the dose needs to be half because the metabolism is inhibited, and dose when it is combined with carbamazepine, it has to be doubled because it is an enzyme inducer. So metabolism will be induced, it will not show effectiveness, so you need to double the dose. Then the next drug is ziprasidone. It is the latest antipsychotic having blockage tendency at D2 receptor, 5-HT2A, 2C, H1 and alpha-1 receptors also. Apart from this, it has antagonistic property at 5-HT1D receptor, agonistic property at 5-HT1A receptor, and also it can inhibit the reuptake of 5-HT and NA. Okay, so because of these, it also has anti-anxiety property and anti-depression property also. Okay, like other atypical antipsychotics, this drug also has low tendency to precipitate the extrapyramidal side effects or hyperprolactinemia due to weaker D2 blocking tendency. Sedation may be precipitated, hypotension, then weight gain or blood sugar level rise may be seen. Nausea and vomiting are quite common side effects. Okay, then this is quite important. QT prolongation may be seen again, so cardiac arrhythmias may be precipitated, especially those who are predisposed or who are at risk. Okay, then T half-life is 8 hours, so twice daily dosing is required because it is a short acting agent. Efficacy is equal to haloperidol, and it is also indicated in mania. The next drug is amisulpiride. This is again a congener of a typical antipsychotics, but have atypical antipsychotic like actions, like because it is having less tendency to produce extrapyramidal side effects, improves the negative symptoms also of schizophrenia. Okay, so it has D2 blocking tendency, D3 blocking tendency also is there, okay, but low tendency to block the 5-HT2 receptors. Okay, hyperprolactinemia is also taking place with this amisulpiride, similar to typical neuroleptic agents. Then it is also having antidepressant property also to some extent. It is not a sedative drug, sedation is not produced, rather insomnia, anxiety or agitation may be precipitated, weight gain, metabolic changes, these are low, but QT prolongation, that is arrhythmia may be precipitated, especially in the elderly. Okay. Kinetics, if you can see, it is absorbed orally, excreted unchanged in the urine, metabolism does not take place, and the T half life is 12 hours. And the last drug is zotapin. Okay, so it also blocks many of the receptors like D2, D1, 5-HT2, alpha 1 adrenergic and histaminic H1 receptors can be blocked. Also, NA reuptake blocking tendency was also there. Okay, so it will potentiate the noradrenaline action. It is effective in schizophrenia, controlling both positive as well as negative symptoms also. Extrapyramidal side effects are less prominent with this particular agent. Okay, but more as compared to the clozapine. If you compare it with typical neuroleptics, it is less, but when you compare it with clozapine, it is more. Hyperprolactinemia is also seen. Then seizure precipitating tendencies are also more at high doses. It will lower the threshold. Weight gain, then hyperglycemia, dyslipidemia, that is increase in the blood lipids, are also more likely. And most common side effects include weakness, headache and postural absorption after oral ingestion is good, but first pass metabolism takes place, that's why the bioavailability is low. The T half life is 14 hours, so quite a long acting agent. As such, it has no specific advantages. It is available in India, but no specific advantages are seen. Discontinued in certain countries like United Kingdom. Okay, so not quite an effective agent.